challenge to an unruly ally. And democracy is not part of the mission. But still unsettled, if the president thinks you deserve the answer to this question, how many more American sons and daughters will be sent to Afghanistan?
We will not talk about numbers of troops or our plans for further military activities. Conditions on the ground, not arbitrary timetables, will guide our strategy from now on.
While fog hovers over the future for U.S. troops, the present still sounds an awful lot like the past.
Our commitment is not unlimited, and our support is not a blank check.
This effort must be based on performance. The days of providing a blank check are over.
From now on, victory will have a clear definition.
As your commander-in-chief, I owe you a mission that is clearly defined.
And where other Republicans see equivocation on neo-Nazis that compromise the president's moral authority and raise questions about his competency, his vice president sees pitch-perfect consistency.
I know this president. I know his heart. And I heard him. I heard him on the day that the Charlottesville tragedy happened, when he denounced hate and violence in all of its forms, from wherever it comes. I heard him on that Monday, and I heard him as well on Tuesday, like millions of Americans did, where he condemned the hate and the bigotry that was evidenced there.
Here to share their reporting and their insights, Julie Pace of the Associated Press, Bloomberg's Tolu Olorunipa and Margaret Taleb, and CNN's Nia Malika Henderson. This morning, big Republican praise for a hawkish plan. Foreign policy heavies and members of the leadership all have a similar message. President Trump made the right call and now has the right approach. The amens echoing across Republican corridors in Washington signify just how sharply President Trump broke from his own past. The president has long held the belief that the United States should bring its troops home from Afghanistan, that the war was a waste of money and a hopeless endeavor. He acknowledged as much in a remarkable moment for a president who hates to admit was wrong.
Original instinct was to pull out. And historically, I like following my instinct. But all my life, I've heard that decisions are much different when you sit behind the desk in the Oval Office.
Now, more on the president's mea culpa of sorts in a moment. But first, just on the address, Julie, I mean, this was meant to provide a new, clearer strategy, way forward, something that people have been asking for. And it seems like there's still a lot of unanswered questions about what exactly this new strategy is.
There are huge unanswered questions, and it's really surprising, actually, for an American president to announce a plan that we know from senior officials is going to include increasing the number of troops that are going overseas, and to not lay that out clearly. That's just generally something that has been part of a president's responsibility to the American people. But beyond that, he talked about victory, committing to winning this war, and then gave some pretty broad parameters for what that would entail. And that has been kind of the problem that President Bush and President Obama have had, that the situation in Afghanistan is so complicated. You're dealing with a country that is quite poor, that has corruption that is really rooted into its government, that has a Taliban that is resurgent now at this point. So how do you define the end game here? The challenge that Trump faced is that pulling out leaves a vacuum. It's really hard to see how that changes in the next couple of years.
Yeah, and also the question is how many more troops will be sent, and whether or not more troops, the 4,000 number, if that is the actual number, will actually make any difference to what we've seen, as you mentioned, a war that's been dragging on and with no clear signs of victory. Vice President Mike Pence was on the morning shows this morning, asked specifically about the troop level numbers, and he suggested that they really have not made a decision on that quite yet.
The answer to that, I think, will be based on the conditions on the ground. I think it's yet to be seen, and we'll certainly be making that information available as the president receives recommendations.
Tolu, do you expect that the administration is going to have to, at some point, detail how many troops are being sent to inform the public about what exactly is going on over there?
Well, they are not. They don't really have a choice because this is something that's eventually going to go before Congress. Members of Congress are going to call hearings. They're going to want to know what the president's plan is and how much it's going to cost. They have the strings of the purse, and they'll have the ability to ask questions and figure out what the end game is. The president said yesterday that this is not going to be a time-based approach. It's going to be a condition-based approach. And that means that members of Congress are going to know what are the conditions that would allow us to have a drawdown in Afghanistan. What are the milestones that the president is hoping to reach in order to get to a point where this America's longest war can come to an end? And we didn't hear that last night.
Yeah, and some members of the foreign policy establishment are praising that approach. A lot of Republicans are praising that approach. General Michael Hayden also saying that this was a good idea as well, suggesting that keeping this option open of troops is a good idea. But it was also remarkable to hear the president last night suggest that he, or say that he thought differently on the campaign trail and coming to this position now because of what he's learned as president. Some of his surrogates, including Nikki Haley, were asked about that this morning. This is how she explained this president's change of approach.
Well, I think that really shows the signs of a president. You know, one thing is to be a candidate and talk about what you think. The other thing is to be a president and talk about what you know. And the facts were put on the table, and he asked all the right questions, and you're going to see a very different approach. Our enemies are no longer going to know what our timeline is. Our enemies are no longer going to know where we are and how many troops and all of those things.
But, Margaret, some of President Trump's allies in the past are not so happy. Breitbart reporting this last night, saying Trump reverses course, will send more troops to Afghanistan. They called him a flip-flopper. And also Laura Ingraham, one of President Trump's defenders, yeah, someone who had been considered for a position in the administration at one point, tweeted last night, "Who's going to pay for it? What is our measure of success? We didn't win with 100,000 troops. How will we win with 4,000 more? I thought we were going to drain the swamp in Washington, not clear the desert in Afghanistan."
Yeah, if you set aside the military and the policy implications for a minute and just look at the politics, this is going to be one of the first major tests of the Trump presidency in the post-Bannon era. And it's only been a couple days, just to remind everyone. But, you know, I think we'll see this play out in terms of the approach to Afghanistan, in terms of tax reform, which is to come soon. But on Afghanistan, this was kind of one of the central premises of the Trump campaign, is to focus more on the United States, to stop trying to solve everybody else's problems. That Afghanistan was kind of a losing fight to be in. And although we can look at last night's speech in terms of all the questions it left unanswered, I think this is one of those inside the bubble, outside the bubble things. Inside the bubble, I think President Trump felt he was finally providing some clarity after a summer of intense divisions internally at the White House. I mean, it's been weeks, maybe even months, since he essentially told Mattis, "Look, this is going to be your call on how many in that sort of 3,000 to 5,000 range to deploy." Mattis waiting to get some clarity, sign off from the president on his overall policy before making those decisions. But internally, just tremendous back and forth about what the president was willing to accept. Whether, I mean, this is months ago that the generals wanted to send a few thousand more from a tactical perspective, really not even a strategic perspective. And we're just now getting to the point.
And there was a fierce debate within the administration. James Mattis, the Secretary of Defense, actually a couple months ago, June 6th, suggested something that essentially is a lot different than what the president suggested last night, when the president said there are some elements of the Taliban where they could potentially reach a deal with, a political settlement with. Now, Mattis addressed this a couple months ago.
"We're up against an enemy that knows that they cannot win at the ballot box. And you think we have to sometimes remind ourselves of that reality. That's why they use bombs, because ballots would ensure they never had a role to play. And based upon that foundation, that they cannot win the support, the affection, the respect of the Afghan people."
And yeah, it seems like it's uncertain what the end game is here for the White House.
That's right. And, you know, you had Nikki Haley there talk about this is a very different strategy. It's not really that different. A lot of the things about here, including whether or not the Republican ends up coming to the table and there's some sort of compromise, that too, something that has been considered and talked about. So, you know, I think we will see how much Bannon, Breitbart, Bannon-Bart, whatever you want to call it, how much he actually speaks for the base and whether or not Donald Trump actually has the power to change the base's mind on this, because we've seen that in any number of instances where he says something and the base essentially echoes what he says, even if he tweets something that's not true. Sometimes you see in polls some of his supporters actually believe that falsehood. So I think we're really going to see sort of how powerful that Bannon wing is and whether or not that affects what the president says. And also, if he sticks to this, right? I mean, we've seen this president flip-flop, sort of go along on things and then go back and criticize them later on. So we'll see.
And this is going to be a challenge for Trump, because we know that he follows his coverage very closely.
Right.
And anytime that you're deepening a U.S. commitment to a war, your coverage isn't going to be great.
Right.
Americans generally are war weary at this point. Does President Trump have it in him right now to have day after day on a Breitbart, for example, negative coverage of this decision and to stick with it because he believes ultimately it's the best decision for the country? I don't think we've actually had to see him in that kind of situation yet.
Yeah, and we know now that this is the president's war. He may not have been for it. He may have suggested they withdraw the troops, but clearly the president owns this. And
even though he is, I think, still trying to get some separation by not announcing how the troop levels. I mean, he's kind of trying to play coy here and be like, oh, we don't really want to telegraph, but he isn't really, I think, owning it fully by announcing we're putting these troops on the ground, whether it's 4,000 or 3,000.
But the troop range that has always been conceived is modest. Not to say that if that is you or your child going off to serve, it's your life is still on the line very much, but this was always viewed as a modest and a tactical effort to try to hold gains and preserve the space, the ability for the Afghan government to stand up. There are no quick fixes. This was never intended as a quick fix.
Yeah, the question is, how long will this U.S. engagement be, given that this is the country's longest war? A lot more to discuss ahead. An update on the U.S. destroyer collision in the Pacific that left 10 sailors missing. The Navy confirms divers have discovered some remains inside the compartments aboard the USS McCain. Investigators are working to identify those remains. Ships, divers, and planes continue to search the area. It's still uncertain how many sailors remain missing. The collision between a guided missile destroyer and an oil tanker happened Monday just east of Singapore. A military official tells CNN that USS McCain lost steering before the collision, though it's unclear why the crew wasn't able to use the backup system on board. That investigation continues. Up next, the president speaks out again about Charlottesville while chaos breaks out at the city's council meeting. We'll show you what happened next. Moments ago, President Trump boarded Air Force One at Joint Base Andrews. He's headed to Arizona, where he'll first visit the Border Patrol in Yuma, then later tonight hold a rally in Phoenix. We will bring that speech to you live. Protesters erupt in Charlottesville again, this time during a heated city council meeting. Watch what happened Monday as council members met for the first time since last week's violent clashes between white supremacists and counter-demonstrators. Protesters slammed city council members for the response to last week's violence. At least three people were arrested. And just another reminder that tensions are still very, very high. Something that was not lost on President Trump, who opened his address on Afghanistan last night with a call for unity.
A soldier understands what we as a nation too often forget, that a wound inflicted upon a single member of our community is a wound inflicted upon us all. When one part of America hurts, we all hurt. And when one citizen suffers an injustice, we all suffer together. When we open our hearts to patriotism, there is no room for prejudice, no place for bigotry, and no tolerance for hate.
And this morning, Vice President Mike Pence and U.S. Ambassador to the U.N. Nikki Haley defended the president.
I think he clarified the importance of unity. He clarified the fact that there is no room for bigotry in our country.
The president specifically denounced white supremacists, neo-Nazis, and the KKK repeatedly. And he did it on, he did it when he denounced hate and violence on Saturday. He did it in his address to the nation Monday. And he did it again in the press conference
when David
Tuesday.
There was
no moral equivalency drawn by the president.
So Vice President Pence sees consistency in the president's remarks.
I mean, if there had been consistency, if there had been clarity, Nikki Haley wouldn't have had to have that question asked of her and make that response. Mike Pence wouldn't have had to do that. I mean, there hadn't been consistency. There hadn't been clarity. What there has been over these last days is a lot of outrage from Republican and Republican lawmakers. Newt Gingrich, for instance, who has been Donald Trump's wingman for months and months and months, came out and said that he was on an island on this and should have been a clear corker, same thing. So, you know, I mean, they're sort of doing cleanup duty, but it's necessary because, as Paul Ryan said last night in our town hall, Donald Trump messed up on this.
Yeah, and perfect segue. We didn't even plan that. Paul Ryan did address this last night. We have not heard from him speaking about this. He had issued some statements, but they did not actually call out the president by name. The first time he addressed this was last night talking to
It was not only morally ambiguous, it was equivocating.
The people who applauded his remarks on Tuesday were David Duke and
Richard
Spencer.
That's why I said those remarks, he messed up on Tuesday. He was right on Monday, and he was right just about an hour ago. I think we were right. He was wrong on
when Tuesday. He was reading from Pope. Yeah.
Do we think that this is going to be enough for Republicans, the fact that the president did make this remark last night, but did not actually say the word Charlottesville? It seems to be enough for Paul Ryan. Do we think this is going to calm the concerns within the party?
I think Republicans want to move on as quickly as possible from this. Clearly, they have taken a hit over the last couple of weeks, and they realize that it was important for them to distance themselves from the president and make sure that they draw clear lines between what the president said and where their position was on the issue of the KKK and these neo-Nazis. And I think the president gave them a little bit of room last night with his statement, something that they can hold on to and say, this is something that we agree with, that we all need to come together for unity. But if you remember what you just showed with the Charlottesville, the city meeting, it's clear that this is something that has touched a nerve across the country.
Yeah.
There is this debate going on about Confederate monuments. This is going to be something that continues on through much of the summer, even as Congress has a number of other things they have to do between now and the end of September.
Yeah, that's right. And one reason it was interesting to see Ryan last night not try to go too far, going after the president, would not call him to apologize, but you know, said that he messed up, despite Jake Tapper pushing him on that issue. And perhaps this is one reason why. Take a look at these poll numbers from ABC News, Washington Post yesterday about the president's approval about how he handled the Charlottesville response. Among U.S. adults, just 28% approved of the way he handled it. 62%, however, of Republicans approved of the way he handled it. Do we think Republicans and lawmakers here are seeing very different things back home than what they may be hearing nationally?
Absolutely. And this has been the challenge for them consistently with Trump, is that, you know, 62% of his own party thinks he did okay. That's still not great.
Right.
But it's a pretty loyal chunk of the party that's there. And Republicans look at their own electoral prospects and say, well, if I turn on the president on one issue or many issues, what happens to that group of voters? Because I can't win without them either. And it's this constant battle that they're in between how far they can go in distancing him and maintaining the support of Trump's voters. And increasingly, Trump's voters are kind of okay with turning their backs on the Republican Party as we know it.
Right. And then we've seen that all along. What was also interesting from that poll, talking about people who hold actually neo-Nazi views in this country, 9% of the country believes that's acceptable.
That's
83%
yeah,
believe
that's
it's unacceptable.
Yeah.
Some people were surprised it's that high. Some people are surprised that it's that low. But one of the things, of course, the president said last week was that there were some very fine people who are marching alongside those trying to get rid of the Lee Monument in Charlottesville. Today, Mike Pence was asked about the monuments, removing monuments. This is what he said.
Someone who believes in more monuments, not less monuments. What we ought to do is we ought to remember our history, but we also ought to celebrate the progress that we've made since that history.
Margaret, do you think this is an issue that the White House wants to be talking about?
No, that's not a general election position. It's a primary position. I think when you look at the surrogates that the White House has chosen to put out there today, Nikki Haley and Mike Pence, what Nia said earlier is important. This is a signaling to the Republican Party. And these are two people who, if President Trump were not running for re-election, I think we can all argue would most certainly be heavily eyeing their prospects. So it's a woman, it's a man. Woman of color represent different swaths of the country geographically in terms of the Republican Party, but they're both very much Republican Party names and faces, and this is an effort to rally the party together to keep the establishment of the party as supportive of the president as possible while he continues to figure out how to message to the base in a way that's more politically acceptable.
And the constant balancing act from the White House and the members of the Republican Party. We've seen this since last campaign season. We're going to continue to see it. More ahead up next. Trump back on the road for a rally tonight in Arizona. Usually his visit starts in Yuma, where Trump will tour a U.S. Customs and Border Protection facility. He'll also meet with U.S. Marines before heading to Phoenix for a nighttime rally that's expected to draw thousands of supporters and protesters. Besides how peaceful it will be, another looming question in the run-up to that event is whether the president will follow up this tweet with an official endorsement of Senator Jeff Flake's challenger in the GOP primary. CNN asked Flake about that yesterday.
How about the president calling you a non-factor in the Senate and toxic?
I don't worry about it at all. I'm going ahead and doing my job.
The president's place to endorse a primary challenger, particularly someone against someone from his own party?
That's not my realm. That's somebody else's. So I just, we're running my own campaign. It's going well. And, you know, what the president does, that's his prerogative.
And yet another subplot we're watching as Trump heads west, the possibility that he'll pardon former Maricopa County Sheriff Joe Arpaio, who was found guilty of criminal contempt for refusing to follow a judge's order barring from racially profiling Latinos. But Trump hinted last week he may let Arpaio off the hook. Arpaio, however, has not said he's been invited to tonight's rally. So we have three White House reporters at this table.
Yeah.
What are we hearing? Is the president going to issue a pardon of Arpaio?
Well, that's a big question. I mean, Arpaio has come played cute on this a little bit. The White House is trying to be cute about it as well. This would be a pretty controversial thing for the president to get on stage and do. Typically, presidents don't issue pardons at this point in their presidency with, for someone like this in general. But that Flake subplot is, I actually think, one of the more interesting ones. I mean, you can see the awkward position that Flake is in written all over his face in that clip there. The idea that a president who is 7 months into his term is targeting a senator of his own party, that's not normal. That doesn't happen. I think sometimes we lose sight of that in all of the hecticness and all of the antics that we go through here, but that is not normal.
It is remarkable. You've not seen this outward level of aggression towards a single senator from your own party. Typically, you want to preserve your seats in the Senate
right.
and go after Democrats. But on this rally tonight, there is a lot of concern from Republicans about what he's going to do and how aggressive he's going to be. Will he be off script? Will he take himself off message after his party thought he had a good night? And a lot of people, including the mayor of Phoenix, have asked President Trump not to attend. And if he is attending, this is the message from the mayor of Phoenix.
Instead of talk about pardoning people, instead of getting involved in intra-party fights for the Republican nomination for Senate, instead the president should take this moment, speak directly to the American people.
What are you hearing from White House officials about this event tonight? Do we expect him to be not throwing the red meat that he tends to do? Do we expect a red meat speech? Or is he going to try to stick to the script like he did last night?
Well, unfortunately for White House officials, they have a limited amount of power over what the president can do. We remember the press conference last week at Trump Tower, where the president went rogue and started taking questions, much to the chagrin of the White House officials who had wanted him to talk about infrastructure. That could be the case again here in Arizona. the president has a rally. We've seen these rallies in the past. The president gets riled up. He sees the big crowd. Sometimes there are protesters, and he lets loose. He attacks the media. He attacks his opponents. He attacks Democrats. A lot of times, he even attacks members of his own party.
And that person could be Jeff Flake, as we were just talking about.
Or even John McCain. Which would be, I mean, my goodness, lacking empathy. He just had chemotherapy. He's suffering from brain cancer. So we'll see what he says. Last week, he sort of referred to John McCain as the one who voted against the health care bill. So we'll see what he says. You know, I think to the base, Arizona is ground zero for anti-immigration policies they liked in many ways. He'll certainly, I think, he's going to the border. He's going to talk about the crackdown in terms of flow of illegal immigrants to the country. But does that again, sort of, does it contradict his message from yesterday, this idea about unity and coming together in sweetness and light? Does he sort of overturn that with whatever he does?
And will this civil war within his own party intensify after tonight? We talked about Jeff Flake. He was asked about this rise of populism within his party. It's pretty clear who Jeff Flake is talking about.
I'm very concerned at where we are today. I'm concerned that the party is going down a populist route. You know, populism is called populism for a reason. It may be popular. You might be able to win elections that way, but it's not a governing philosophy. And I'm concerned about where the party might be going there as well, if we follow the lead of some individuals who would give in to that kind of destructive behavior. So you can have a partisan debate, but it can't get ugly. And we've got to get away from calling our opponents losers or clowns.
Pretty clear who he's talking about there.
Loser was the dead giveaway.
Loser was the dead giveaway. But, you know, last week the president did something unbelievably remarkable, coming out and saying that he's essentially endorsing Kelly Ward, yeah. One of the primary challengers against Jeff Flake, as Julie was discussing. Have you heard about whether or not the president's actually going to offer an official endorsement of her tonight?
Yeah, we've heard very little from White House officials when asked about kind of all aspects of what's his messaging going to be tonight, other than what's obvious on sort of the policy front, which is to emphasize during this trip today the apprehensions at the border, which have actually changed some of the dynamics. And the numbers don't lie. The numbers tell a story.
And I want to show you just one quick ad from a group that was linked to Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, his super PAC, going after Jeff Flake's opponent, really just showing this battle that's happening within the party right now.
Now, after losing big league to John McCain, Chemtrail Kelly says he should resign so she can be senator.
Step away as quickly as possible.
I should be at the top of the list for appointment to that Senate seat.
Embarrassing behavior. Dangerous ideas. No wonder Republicans rejected her just 1 year ago. Chemtrail Kelly. Not conservative. Just crazy ideas.
Brutal ad from someone.
They're basically calling her crazy.
They're
right?
An ad that Jeff Flake himself will never personally
right. Exactly. Right. You know, Kelly Ward is someone who ran against John McCain last year and lost pretty handedly in this primary. Do we think the White House, the president at all, is getting the message from Republican leaders who are saying, and everybody, all Republican senators are saying, stay away from these intra-party fights.
No. Not at this stage. And this is absolutely meant to send a signal to other lawmakers who are standing for re-election and could face primary challenges, that if they cross the president, if they speak out against him, if they don't go along with his policy approaches, that they could be in trouble at home. You got to get through a primary in order to stand in the general election for re-election. And that's still the dynamic we're looking at heading towards the end of this August recess into this really important chapter in the Trump administration's, where we see everything from debt ceiling fight, whether there's going to be a government shutdown, the approach on tax reform. We've got a period of 3 months or so that are going to absolutely tell a story that are going to shape the midterm elections and the president's approach to government.
And also a perfect segue to our next segment. Coming up next, when the president criticizes his own party, he does not tend to mince words. But House Speaker Paul Ryan still tries to strike a balance between...
Mitt Romney said President Trump needs to apologize.
He needs to do better, and I think he just... are those some of those tweets that I prefer not to have seen? Of course there are. But at the end of the day, what I control are my own actions. And I think the president, in my own view of it, he likes the unpredictability side of this. And I think it's important that Kim Jong-un is called to the carpet when he does this kind of reckless rhetoric.
That was Speaker Paul Ryan last night with Jake Tapper at a CNN town hall event. Republicans have struggled to distance themselves from the president, seeming to equate neo-Nazis with those protesting against them without taking it too far. Here's what the speaker had to say when asked whether he would support an official censure of the president for what he said.
I will not support that. I think that would be so counterproductive. If we descend this issue into some partisan hack fest, into some bickering against each other and demean it down to some political food fight, what good does that do to unify this country?
President Trump in recent weeks has been more than happy to take on Republicans via Twitter. Remember this? The president slammed Senator Lindsey Graham, calling him, quote, publicity seeking after Graham slammed his Charlottesville response. And then there was the president's feud with Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, the president hammering him for the failed Republican effort to repeal and replace Obamacare. And Trump did not spare Senator Lisa Murkowski either after she came out against the GOP repeal plan. The question is, how come the president is so quick to go after his own party when there are so many Democrats up for re-election? Just a list of the vulnerable Democrats up for re-election. It states that Trump actually won by more than 19 points. Senator Joe Manchin of West Virginia, Heidi Heitkamp of North Dakota, Joe Donnelly of Indiana, Claire McCaskill of Missouri, John Tester of Montana. You're pick up opportunities, but the president spends most of his time going after his own party.
It is really bizarre. I mean, Democrats are really worried about all of those races that you just put up on the screen because Trump won in those states, and they tend to be states that tend to be a little more conservative, and they know that they're going to have a hard time even in a midterm election year where the president's party tends to do pretty poorly. But they're kind of watching in awe about Trump not going after these people. I mean, this is a gift to a Claire McCaskill or a Joe Donnelly, giving them a little bit of breathing room, at least in their home state, to be able to push their own message forward instead of worrying about the president tweeting at them every morning.
And we discussed this in the last segment, too, about the challenges in balancing this, the president going after them or attacking the president, staying with the president, deciding this is more of a, you know, they'll go after him over specific issues and they'll be with them behind others. And one reason why, and we discussed this earlier as well, the congressional agenda is intense when they get back in September. They have to deal with raising the debt ceiling, which is a perennial problem for the Republicans. They have to pass a spending bill to keep the government open past September 30th. And they want to do big things like tax reform, which is very difficult to accomplish. Infrastructure, they have no agreement within their own party or with Democrats, and potentially even a fix on the Obamacare exchanges and individual insurance markets. Do we expect that this feud within the party is going to make it harder for them to get this done?
You know, you imagine so. I mean, I guess the big question for Donald Trump all along is why can't he make friends more easily, right? Not only why is he not going after those Democrats, why didn't he try to bring them into the tent and then maintain some of those relationships? And I mean, if you talk to Republicans early on, they want this president to succeed. They want to be for him, and they've been disappointed. But they have, I think, typically been with him. We talked about this, a Flake even, right? I mean, Flake hasn't really done anything to go against this president in terms of policy, right? He was on the president's side in terms of health care. So, you know, I am interested to see whether or not, and I know we always talk about this, whether or not there'll be a new version of Trump, but really will they be a new version of Trump post-Bannon, whether we had Bannon in the White House sort of stoking this intra-party fight among the GOP, and we all know that Bannon is anti-establishment, and going forward, whether or not there's sort of a more Kelly influence, and we'll see something different, whether or not he drops what you were talking about before, you know, stoking these primary challenges.
And one of the things that is looming over this as well is the Russia investigation. This is going to, of course, it continued to percolate today. Actually, Glenn Simpson, who is the co-founder of that research firm, Fusion GPS, the one that actually hired that British intelligence agent to investigate possible campaign coordination contacts with Russians, later led to that now infamous dossier that that a lot of it has unsubstantiated allegations the president has gone after. Glenn Simpson actually meeting behind closed doors with the Senate Judiciary Committee earlier today as part of their investigation. But still, that committee wants to talk to Donald Trump Jr. They want to talk to Paul Manafort. There is still the special counsel's investigation. This is going to be a huge thing. The president, You've not talked about that a lot recently, but it's still hovering over this presidency.
Well, it certainly is, and I think when you go to the question of why is the president going after fights inside his own party when he's got Democrats to worry about, it seems to me that the president's calculus thus far is that Democrats are not well enough organized to take advantage of it, and that it doesn't do you that much good to have your own party in control when your own party is investigating you. Yeah. It doesn't do the stuff you want them to do on health care and won't pass the bills you want them to pass. Now, the alternative is obviously much worse politically for President Trump. And if he reaches the point where he believes that Democrats are actually poised to take over a chamber, I think you'd probably see a slightly different approach politically. But for now, those primary fights, the threats of those primary fights, the potential to shape the way Republicans behave, I think is very much part of his thinking. And he's very frustrated with his own party for seeming to go along with Democrats and not taking a bipartisan approach to the Russia probe.
Absolutely. So more on that ahead. And next, the wife of one of the Trump's key cabinet secretaries gets a lesson in the perils of social media. You can